It was on a Monday, and when we went into the hospital with our little one, and the doctor was very upfront and very clear that these are the options. You know, she could get sick, she'll be sick, and she'll get better. She'll be sick, she could have organ damage, and she'll get better. She could get sick, she could have organ damage and need a transplant, or she could die. Those were our choices.
And the chair is pleased to recognize Mrs. Tremel from Luxembourg, Wisconsin, a tremendous community of caring people, and thank you for coming here to Washington to give us your story.
My name is Judy Tremel. I'm here representing myself, my husband, Scott, and my three daughters, Caitlin, Emily, and Samantha. If you look at these three bottles of water, two of them are polluted with E. coli. One of them is not. If I asked you to pick which bottle you think is the clean water of the three, which one would you pick? If you picked this one and you drank this one, this water, or gave it to your infant daughter, you would be poisoning her with E. coli.
Incubation for E. coli poisoning is between 4 and 10 days. On the fourth day is when my littlest got sick, and we woke up Friday morning and we opened her bedroom door, and it was her crib. She was just covered in feces. She had the diarrhea and vomit everywhere. We had a safe drinking water test about 2 weeks before a farmer spread manure on a field across the road from our house, and we had no idea. We'd lived in the country for years and never knew that spreading manure on a farm field in the winter would contaminate groundwater.
I grew up along the Niagara Escarpment, and on my home farm, my dad's farm, we were next door to a quarry. So to me, water availability and water quality was just something I grew up with.
Basically, we're in a karst landscape. It's a type of terrain where it's common to see sinkholes, very little surface streams. Most of them immediately go into swallow holes and flow underground and emerge as springs.
The biggest problem with groundwater when it gets polluted is trying to trace the source of the pollution is very difficult. You can't actually see it. It's below ground. It's impossible to, you know, follow it real well. And the groundwater just kind of, we don't know where it goes or where it comes from. It just is.
A lot of people, we try to educate them because they can't see. They see a opening in the ground. They figure once you pour something in there, you don't have to go to a landfill. It just disappears and out of sight, out of mind. Well, what they aren't realizing is that this plumbing system is directing it right back towards their wells.
So when there's a problem with pollution, trying to go back to the source and stop it is difficult.
The family farms are getting fewer, and the industrial farms are getting bigger.
There's people that say we should go back to the Red Barn era, and I grew up in that era. I miss that era. And everybody talks that it's because of economical reasons that there's that change, but it's a lifestyle type change. There is no right or wrong size to farming, and we'll continue to talk about it and get better at it.
We went from having 50 farms in Kewaunee County to having 4 big ones. The summer before that happened, he just got his permit to expand, even though he didn't have enough manure storage for what he had. He had gotten the CAFO status, you know, which is the concentrated animal feeding operation status.
An average cow eats about 100 pounds as fed, drinks about 30 gallons of water on an average, and on an average produce about 30 pounds of manure that we put through our system on a daily basis.
Water is vitally important to the health of our cattle as well as ourselves, but a mature cow will drink 50 gallons of water a day. So we need a lot of water, we need good quality water in order to produce good quality milk.
The manure is scraped multiple times a day to a central system that actually takes out, and we recycle the sand that's utilized for the bedding for cows. We take out the large particle fiber. It's stored in lagoons until field conditions allow us to apply. That nutrient management plan takes a bunch of information. Soil samples to determine what the soil's needs are, what crops are being grown, and the majority of the manure is applied in a fall setting in preparation for the next year's growing crop.
Right now, a lot of the farms are self-regulated, which is not a good idea. They rely on them to report themselves. They've restructured the DNR since our case, which they took even more regulators away from having to monitor these farms up close.
I have files and files and files of paperwork. And it's an annual thing. You can't just fill out the paper one time. Every year we have to give them another plan. And they come and they go through the whole thing again. They'll spend time out here with a transit and a level, making sure that the water that runs off of the roof, the water that runs off of our cow yard, is all properly distributed. It has to run through a grass waterway and be filtered. And so they spend time out here doing that. They do soil tests. They do a lot of different things to make sure that we're doing the best we can.
The issues we ran into with the DNR were that they just weren't enforcing. They had rules that they could enforce, they just didn't. People in that area had gotten so complacent because they would call the DNR and the DNR wouldn't respond. Now, we weren't the first family that had our water polluted. It took a town of 100 in Brown County, the town of Morrison, where 100 wells went bad, and they linked it right to a farm. They were able to source it right to a farm. They give them these permits to pollute, which is what they have. It's a Wisconsin discharge elimination pollution permit. And then they don't monitor them on the amount of pollution that they're putting out.
You can't tell people that you can't farm in you know, areas, but what you can do is try to make sure that you don't have agricultural runoff going into streams, especially sinkholes as well. And so it's a kind of a balancing act.
As a farmer, you feel like it's both your privilege to live here, but also your right to take something from it, to make a living from it. And so you become emotionally attached in a way because it's your life. Everything that you do, everything that you have comes from the soil, from the water, from the natural resources that are around us. We want to be good stewards of the land, good caretakers, as well as profit from it.
As civilization has changed, we're all responsible for water pollution. The way the needs and the wants that our society has all affect water quality. So we're all part of that, and we all have to work towards a solution.
I have a lot of sadness for the way Wisconsin is going when it comes to this issue, because I think it's going to take some catastrophe, something bigger than what happened to us, for somebody to finally do something. And they're getting there. We're getting more and more cases of this happening. And I think until somebody dies or they have, you know, deaths that they have to deal with, that they will continue to let it be the way that it is.